Books on Tape presents Condoleezza Rice, An American Life by Elisabeth Bumiller. Read by Kimberly Farr.
Introduction. September 11th, 2001, dawned brilliant and clear in Washington, a gorgeous late summer day. Condoleezza Rice, 8 months into her job as National Security Advisor to President George W. Bush, was in her office, as usual, around 6 a.m., happy to have some breathing space with the president away. Bush was on an overnight trip to Florida to visit a Sarasota elementary school and to push for an education bill that was languishing in Congress. It was also minor, just a little trip to Florida, Rice recalled, that neither she nor her deputy, Stephen Hadley, had bothered to accompany him. One of them was usually along on presidential trips to handle whatever national security questions might come up. But in this case, they sent Deborah Lower, a Navy captain who was the director of the White House Situation Room. Rice was standing at her desk shortly before 9 a.m. when her assistant came in to tell her that a plane had hit the World Trade Center. Rice thought it was odd, but she assumed that a small plane had veered out of control. Within moments, her assistant came back to say that the plane was in fact a commercial airliner. Rice thought that was unusually odd. So I called the president and he'd just heard and he said, "That's a really strange accident," Rice recalled. And I said, "Yeah, it really is." She told Bush she would get back to him when she knew more. Minutes later, Rice was in a meeting of her top aides in the conference area of the Situation Room when her assistant handed her a note saying that a second plane had struck the World Trade Center. Andrew H. Card, Jr., the White House Chief of Staff, had just whispered the same thing into Bush's ear in the Florida classroom, adding, as if he already knew that he was speaking for history, that America is under attack. Rice, like everyone else at the White House, knew immediately it was terrorism. "I have to go," she abruptly told her staff. Rice, the first African-American woman to become National Security Advisor and later Secretary of State, headed from the conference area into the Situation Room's Operations Center, where her first thought was to assemble a crisis meeting of the administration's national security team. But she couldn't find Donald Rumsfeld, the Secretary of Defense. Colin Powell, the Secretary of State, was in Peru, and Rice was unable to get a call through to George Tenet, the director of the Central Intelligence Agency. All around her was chaos. Richard Clark, the National Security Council's counterterrorism chief, who had just raced to the Situation Room from a conference 3 blocks away, was living through his worst nightmare as he tried to convene a video conference of his top aides. Bush's motorcade was heading toward Air Force One in Florida, but it was a convoy that did not know where it was ultimately headed. Neither the president nor the Secret Service had decided where Bush should go after his plane took off, and so far the only goal was to get the president up in the air as fast and as high as possible. Franklin Miller, the NSC's senior director for defense, who had joined the group in the Situation Room, recommended to Rice that fighter jet escorts be dispatched to protect Bush's 747. "Make it happen," Rice said, as Miller recalled. Upstairs, where Vice President Dick Cheney remained in his office, the Secret Service had just learned from a tower supervisor at Reagan National Airport that a plane whose pilot refused to communicate appeared to be heading toward the White House. The agents did not know then that the plane was American 77, flown by a Saudi hijacker, Hani Hanjour, and assisted by 2 al-Qaeda terrorists the CIA had failed to put on a watch list. But the news was dire enough for the Secret Service to order the immediate evacuation of the vice president. Agents propelled Cheney out of his chair and into the tunnel leading underneath the White House to the specially designated bunker, officially the Presidential Emergency Operations Center, which had been built below the East Wing as a shelter for Franklin D. Roosevelt during World War II. At the moment Cheney entered the tunnel, 9:37 a.m., American 77 crashed into the Pentagon. Rice, who was still in the Situation Room trying to reach Rumsfeld, looked up and saw the wreckage on television. Within minutes, the Secret Service ordered her to the bunker, too. Rice thought to call her closest living relatives, her uncle and aunt in Birmingham, to tell them that she was okay and to spread the word among the family. Then she was instantly whisked away. Rice got to the bunker around 10 a.m. and took a seat next to the vice president. The next hours would be the most harrowing of her life. They were filled with snap decisions, fragmentary information, reports of impending attacks that proved false, mixed signals, tense phone calls, and nearly unbearable anxiety and confusion. Minutes after arriving, Rice watched the television in disbelief as the South Tower of the World Trade Center collapsed in a massive cloud of dust and debris, killing thousands. There was a groan in the room that I won't forget ever, one witness later said. Then suddenly Rice was whipsawed by reports that yet another inbound aircraft, presumably hijacked, was heading toward Washington. The Air Force was trying to set up a combat air patrol of fighter jets over the nation's capital, a cap in military parlance, and Cheney wanted to establish the rules of engagement. In short, whether the pilots should be authorized to take the extraordinary step of shooting down a commercial airliner loaded with passengers. The president was now aloft on Air Force One, and Rice remembered hearing Cheney inform the president in a phone call to the plane, "Sir, the caps are up. Sir, they're going to want to know what to do." Rice then recalled hearing Cheney say, "Yes, sir." Rice remembered the phone call as occurring within a few minutes, perhaps five, after she arrived in the bunker. As she later recounted it, the Pentagon was asking, "What shall we do if..." And the vice president talked to the president and conveyed that, in fact, they should, if necessary, shoot it down. Within moments, a military aide informed the vice president that the aircraft now heading toward Washington, United 93, was 80 miles out. The aide asked for authority to engage, and Cheney said yes. I. Lewis Scooter Libby, the vice president's chief of staff who was with the group, later described Cheney's decision as quick and decisive, in about the time it takes a batter to decide to swing. The aide returned a few minutes later to say that the plane was now 60 miles out and, no doubt, wanting to make sure that he had absolutely clear instructions for the ghastly event that he thought was about to occur, repeated his request to engage. Cheney again said yes. Joshua Bolton, the White House deputy chief of staff, who was unaware of any previous discussion about shooting down airplanes, had what he later recalled as a quiet moment. He then suggested that the vice president get in touch with the president to confirm the engage order. Cheney did so. On Air Force One, Ari Fleischer, the White House press secretary who was taking notes, recorded at 10:20 a.m. that the president had told him, Fleischer, that he had authorized a shootdown. Back in the bunker, word soon arrived of an aircraft down in Pennsylvania. Rice recalled the sudden horror in the room at what they believed the American fighter jets had done. "We thought we'd shot down a plane," Rice said, "because the plane that crashed in Pennsylvania, we didn't understand what had happened to it, and so I just remember the vice president saying to the Pentagon, 'You must know whether or not we engaged, whether or not a fighter engaged a civilian aircraft. You have to know the answer to that.' Because they kept saying, 'Sir, we're trying to find out.' And then I would get on the phone and say, 'Come on, you've got to tell us. Did we engage a civilian aircraft?'" Within minutes, Rice was focused on a new catastrophe. Reports of another hijacked plane heading toward Washington, this one only 5 to 10 miles out. Believing there was only a minute or two before impact, Cheney once again authorized that it be attacked. Steve Hadley had by now joined the group, and in a conference call with the Pentagon, he conveyed the understated terror of the moment.
I need to get word to Dick Myers that our reports are there's an inbound aircraft flying low 5 miles out, Hadley said, referring to Richard Myers, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The vice president's guidance was we need to take them out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.